You are listening to the Lucha Central Podcast Network. And now, luchacentral.com presents Straight Out of the Bodega with King FatBoy Papo Esco.
From the wrestling world of the podcast world, it's Straight Out of the Bodega with your host,
the King FatBoy Papo Esco.
You have arrived. Pulled up. Welcome to another edition of Straight Out of the Bodega. I am your master of ceremonies, the bully from the bodega, the lucha thug, the one-man lucha gang, El Rey Gordo himself, King FatBoy Papo Esco. Man, I got a lot of names. Oh well. And as always, we're here to take you on a ride. A ride through the blocks, back alleys, and street corners of the bodega. I mean, we're going to give you everything you need. That's pro wrestling and entertainment. I'm ready. I know you're ready. So take a seat, pour up your favorite drink, and let's ride. Summer, summer, summertime. Summertime, time to sit back and unwind. Time to sit back and unwind. Something like that. It's Thursday. Welcome to another edition of Straight Out of the Bodega. I'm your master of ceremonies, King FatBoy Papo Esco. And as I disgustingly sang just a little while ago, it's summertime. Hasn't been too hot, you know, 70s, 80s. Hasn't gotten up to the hundreds, maybe like once or twice. But you know, the California sun's out, and I cannot complain. I'm happy. Also, we're about a couple of days away from Father's Day, and I want to wish all the fathers a happy Father's Day out there. For me, Father's Day hits a little different, and I'll tell you why. First of all, I didn't grow up with a father. He wasn't around, didn't take the time, or didn't even really care to bother. You know, and I could have took that negatively, or I could have took that positively. Now, don't get me wrong, I did lash out of anger because of that. You know, I did get in a lot of trouble because I was pissed off that I saw a lot of kids with their dads and I wasn't there with mine. But I mean, I did spin it into a positive thing. You know, I got my own kids, I got a daughter, I got a son, and I do go out of my way to make sure that they know that they are loved. I go out of my way, to make sure that they know that I am here to shape and nurture their lives into adulthood as best as I can so that they can go out and be successful in their own lives. You know, I instill in them honor, respect, loyalty, responsibility, accountability, you know, all the things that they need to succeed. So I did spend that positively. So to my father, wherever you are, don't come find me first. Secondly, thank you, because it was your neglect and your, invisible man trick that caused me to become the father that I am, and I think I'm a great one. So, that said, everybody who is a father, doing it the right way, happy Father's Day to you. Take a bow, it's your day. Eat up all the barbecue, open up all the gifts, take all the hugs and kisses you can get, and be celebrated. It's your day. I need to hit the pause button right quick because I want to take this time out to say thank you. You could be listening to any podcast in the world right now, but you chose ours. Thank you for pulling up to Straight Out of the Bodega for this episode, all the way back to the first episode and every episode in between. And we hope that you continue to pull up to the podcast as we try to bring you more great content, more great conversation and entertainment. I mean, we trying to take over the podcast world. So help us get the word out. Let everybody you know that we're out there. We're available on all podcast platforms. I'm talking Spotify, Google Podcasts, iTunes, Apple Podcasts, Spreaker, Podbay, Podbean. I mean, the list goes on and on. All they got to do is go to their favorite podcast platform, search Lucha Central Podcast Network or Lucha Central, hit subscribe for Straight Out of the Bodega, rate, review, comment, let us know how we're doing, let us know who or what you want to hear on future episodes, and just help us continue to improve. We're trying to raise the bar and hit these charts, man. So thank you again. Anyway, we got a great show for you today. I know I always say that, but I believe it, so I'm going to say it again. We got a great show for you today. Pulling up to the podcast is AEW's Jungle Boy. I like this guy. He's a good, humble guy. I've worked with him. I've trained with him. Shared a couple of laughs with him. I'm excited that he's pulling up to sit down with us and have a great conversation. We're going to get right into it. But before we do that, I need to send you over to the jaw-dropping, room-stopping, Denise Salcedo with Lucha Central.
Hey everyone, it's Denise Salcedo here in Lucha Central Central with a look at all of the great shows available this week on the Lucha Central Podcast Network. Monday, it's a brand new mass cast with Dos Hermanos Lucha. The brothers are back with their latest advice on how to build the ultimate Lucha Libre mask collection, including what Facebook groups can really help you up your game. Tuesday, it's Mass Mats and Mayhem, the show that brings you back into and behind the scenes of Lucha Underground. This week on the show, more behind-the-scenes secrets are revealed from two of the show's day one luchadores. Plus, the gang discusses the current success of former Lucha Underground stars Karrion Kross and El Hijo del Fantasma, and takes a look back at Season 1, Episode 6. Plus, this Friday, look for a bonus episode of the MMM show focused on Pride Month, including a special interview with former Lucha Underground and current AEW star Sunny Kiss. Also on Tuesday, brand new series Wrestle Boss with Favi Chulo debuts on its regular night with a live call-in show covering pro wrestling and MMA from 7 to 8:30 p.m. Pacific. Then, each Wednesday, the show will be available for download on podcast platforms. The first episode is up now and features interviews with former CMLL, Ring of Honor, and Lucha Underground star Ricky Reyes, Bellator fighter Rick Hahn, and Combate America SVP Mike Aframowitz. This week's guests will include former XPW and Wrestling Society X star and current owner and operator of the Santino Brothers Wrestling Academy, Joey Chaos. With SBW graduates in nearly every major promotion at this point, there is a lot to talk about. Don't miss WrestleBoss Live on Tuesday night and in podcast format on Wednesday. We've also got more live recordings for you on Wednesday as Spanish series La Mesa de los Margaros brings you their unique style of news and comedy along with special guests. Watch as they record their episode on Facebook Live and then download the episode Thursdays. Also on Thursday, it's Straight Out of the Bodega with Papo Esco with special guests, PWR Training Academy graduate and AEW star Jungle Boy Jack Perry. Papo and Gabe talk with Jack about his training at the academy, his time in the Norcal indie scene, and his signing with AEW. On Friday, we've got the number one Lucha Libre show on the U.S. charts, Lucha Central Weekly, and the number one show wrestling-related, period, on the Mexico iTunes wrestling charts, Lucha Central Weekly en Español. With Lucha Libre slowly returning to Mexico and shows this past weekend from both DTU and IWRG, plus luchadores all over WWE programming these days, we've got two packed shows for you. Be sure to subscribe and follow all of your favorite Lucha Central Network series on your favorite podcast platforms. And please be sure to give a rating and review to help more fans find the shows that you love. For now, this is Denise Salcedo signing off from Lucha Central Central. Have a great week.
All right, welcome back to Straight Out of the Bodega. Like always, I'm your master of ceremonies, the King FatBoy Papo Esco. And as always, I got my partner in crime, my brother, owner and operator of Pro Wrestling Revolution, co-host of the show, Gabe Ramirez. What's going on, man?
Bodega. Every time I hear our show, I always hear you, you know, on the rap songs or singing, and
that's my MO,
like,
man.
I always feel like I'm under, like I'm not utilizing my tools like you are. So I don't know if I should sing or not sing or what to do, but I feel like I'm naked on here. Well, never mind. Yeah. Hey, what's up, Papa? How you doing, my brother? How you doing this evening?
Good, man. Good, man. You know, before we get into it, I wanted to say, dude,
what?
Lucha-masks.com is a beast right now. It's like a train steamrolling down the
track. My brother, no joke. I don't pull no punches. I've been upfront with anyone who's cared to ask and to all my brothers, you guys know. And our landlord doesn't give a rat's ass. I understand his position. You know, he doesn't care that his exact words were the COVID and pandemic was no fault of ours. You still have to pay for your rent. And I wasn't asking for a freebie. I was just asking, can we work something out? You know, can we do something? You're charging me for a building I can't even walk into. And he told me no.
Yeah.
And I literally just didn't know what to do. I mean, I know we're having online classes, but, you know, not everyone stayed. And I still need to generate monetary for this. And we can't do shows. We lost 40 shows. So how are we going to do this? And the guy who makes all our gear in Guadalajara, El Gran Canoe. So I said, hey, brother, I said, bro, I have an idea. Do you think you can do this? And he goes, yeah. What are your thoughts? And so I went online and got a couple of graphics I put together and cut the mannequin's head off and I did all these things and I put a mask on. And then since he makes our gear, I said, hey, can you grab Kukui's mask and all these ideas? And I put it on there. And he made a couple. He goes, what do you think? And I was like, oh, wow. I go, I never thought they'd look this badass. And he sent me a couple and I was like, dude, how many do you need? He goes, for you, whatever you want. So you saw, we ordered like, I don't know, 150 at the most. And we put them on Facebook, man.
And now it's, and now we're in
the thousands. Oh, yeah.
We're making moves, man. This is great.
Honestly, I'm being flat out honest. We're bringing in about 1,000 masks a week. And so, and that's I dope. Tell you what, at first, the mailman and DHL, at first, they would come to our door, you know, they'd knock and, hey, how are you, blah, blah, blah. Hey, you know, you're 6 feet away. Here's your stuff. Man, by week three, they would stop coming into the house. They'd skip the house, even though we're paying them to show up. And so now that things are a little bit looser, as far as here in California, we go into this, I forget what it's called, but you can drop off mail for USPS. And we walk in, they're like, oh, man. Because sometimes we walk in when we can. Like last week, guys, we got our DHL about 2 o'clock. We knocked out about 200 orders by 3:30. And we walked in and dropped them off at the local place. And it was almost closing for them. And then you are dumping, you know, all these masks on them. And they're like, oh. But you know what? Crazy, we're paying the bills. We're trying to keep the doors open. Yep. And you know, I have a family to feed. I have students that I need to keep busy. I have a job to keep a dream alive for a lot of you, and for many that still have to come. So I take a responsibility upon myself to make this happen.
That's awesome. That's absolutely awesome, man. Speaking of dreams, keeping them alive. Speaking of former students, today's show is an awesome one.
Is it better than last week's? Will it be better than last week's? Because last week,
we're outdoing ourselves. We're outdoing ourselves.
This will be the best show ever. And I was like, well, are you saying that?
We're outdoing ourselves.
So this show will be better, right?
Keeps getting better.
All right.
It should be. I'm hoping. So today on the show, we got a young man who, in my opinion, is his stock is rising. You know, he's went from humble beginnings, you know, a former student of Pro Wrestling Revolution Training Academy. And he's on television every single week. You can catch him every single Wednesday on Wednesday Night Dynamite. That's AEW's own Jungle Boy Jack Perry. How you doing, man?
I'm good, man.
It's good to have you on, man. How you been? Yeah. How's everything been going with you personally?
We've been good.
You know, we're trying to maintain in this.
Besides
you know,
being on home arrest, I know.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, but see, Papo's okay with home arrest.
Yeah, that's all that through part's high school, a bummer.
That was his. That he was. You know, he had the beeper on his ankle.
Honestly, though,
it's so good to hear your voice, brother. I miss you so much, man. You know, every time I see you on television and stuff. I so miss you. Every so often when we talk about, you know, Jungle Boy, everyone always has a story, you know, how at the academy, you know, I remember Kukui was telling us the other day, and he says, oh, man, he's all, I miss when Jungle Boy wanted to beat up Mark every day in class. And it cracks us up because it was the simplest thing. But, you know, we miss that, you know. We miss you so much. But we couldn't be prouder of what's going on, you know what I mean?
Absolutely. For me, I don't miss.
Thank you, man.
I mean, well, dude, my spot's solidified now. You know, you're out of my way. You know what I mean? I'm the star now. Okay. All right. You went on to bigger and brighter things.
Just remember
my flag.
Yeah, but just remember that both of you are former Pro Wrestling Revolution tag team champions. Just putting that out there.
That is true, and we're gonna get into all that. You know, I want to start by, you know, just saying that we do miss you, and you know, we want to tell your story in a way that you want it to be told. So I just want to get right into it, man. You know, you have a unique start in this business. I mean, I'm not sure I've ever heard of a professional wrestler who actually started and made his journey so young. Why don't you start off by telling everyone first, when did you fall in love with wrestling, and at such a young age, how did you convince your parents to get you involved and start training?
Yeah, well, it was, I don't remember how old I was, but I was pretty young, and I had these two friends sleeping over, and I'd asked them to sleep over and hang out, and they're like, we would, but we have to go home because we have to watch wrestling tonight. And I was like, well, we can just watch it at my house. You know, and I'd seen a little bit here and there, but I didn't really watch it before that. so that was the deal, to get them to sleep over. I had to watch wrestling with them. And so they did. And it was an episode of SmackDown. And I remember on that episode, I remember being like kind of taken back by the characters and then just the crazy stuff I was seeing. But they had like Boogeyman on there. They had Kurt Angle. They had Rey Mysterio. And when I saw this thing, it was just it was so big and so grand, the entire thing. You know, there's all this crazy athletic stuff going on. There are crazy characters. There are beautiful women. There are fireworks and stuff exploding. And I was just like, damn, this is cool. So then, you know, the next week I checked back in and I watched it again and I watched it again. And I kind of just became a fan. And then I happened to have a trampoline in my backyard, and I figured I would just become a wrestler. And so I'd get my little sister to go out with me, and I'd just try all the things that I'd been seeing on TV. You know, and at first it was just simple
stuff.
I just wanted to clothesline her.
You just wanted to beat up your sister.
Whatever it was. Yeah, so then I mastered
Were those wrestling basics, or is that brother sister basics?
And then I thought, brother, I still haven't got the wrestling basics, but I got those done enough. And then I started trying to have real moves, and then I'd have some of my friends over, and I'd kind of show them the stuff I knew, and I'd try and have little matches and all that. But it got to the point where I was trying to give my sister, like, tombstone pile drivers and stuff. And my parents said to me, they're like, this is obviously something you are very passionate about, and it seems like it's something you want to do. If it is something you're serious about, though, you're going to have to not be doing it on your sister all the time. And we want you to go and learn properly and do it with other consenting
people. So what was the first school that you went to? They found you a school.
Yes, they did. It was with a guy named Rick Drazen, and it was in the Valley in California. And I was in fourth grade, and I remember I'd been talking to my parents about it a little bit. They were like, we found this school. Do you want to do this? And I was like, yeah, hell yeah. And I remember I got picked up early one day from fourth grade, and I knew what it was for. I had a feeling I knew. And my dad picked me up, and we drove over to the Valley and pulled up to this guy's house, and he just had a ring in his backyard. And the first time seeing a ring like that, kind of so up close, like a ring I knew I was going to get in, I was like, wow. Like, I was like, I'm here. Like, this is crazy.
So then that puts you at about 11 years old, dude.
And yet.
somewhere around there. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I was like 10 or 11 then. Yeah. And yeah, so yeah, from, you know, I fell in love with it there for real. It was harder than I realized. It was kind of funny, but I remember the way I had taught myself on the trampoline to take a bump was to jump up and let my head hit at the same time as my back so that it was all flat so that I wouldn't whiplash. And so I got in there and Rick's like, all right, we got to teach you how to take a bump. And I'm just a little dumbass in fourth grade. And I was like, can I just try it? Like, I feel like I know how to do it. And he's like, sure. And I wanted to impress everyone. So I just jumped up in the air as high as I could and just landed completely flat and let my head hit as well. And I knocked myself silly. And I was like, oh my God, this is not the trampoline. So I started from the bottom and yeah, I went every week and, it was cool, but it was hard. I realized right away, I was like, damn, this is, you know, I'd heard a lot of severance. People would say, like, oh, you know, there's a trampoline under the ring, and it's like it's a mattress and all this and that. And
Someone even left the class. Just one bump, and that those theories will change automatically.
Yeah.
So, Jack, you know, I've in my research, I'm hearing that you actually had matches, you know, before you were maybe even 16.
Well, I had matches.
Yeah, I wanted to get into that. Like you actually trained, and then they put you in the ring with some people.
Good Lord, 11?
You were getting it started. Yeah, yeah.
Who had the insurance policy on that show?
Yeah, I you know, I am not sure. I trained.
Oh yeah,
I trained with named Nikki, and she was called Nikki the New York Knockout. You know her, Gabe, right? Yeah. And she kind of took me under her wing, and she, I don't know how, but she got
was she training with you with Rick Grayson?
Her, and it was like a small little show, whatever. But yeah, and she ended up kind of taking over. She would lead a large portion of the class, kind of. You know, you have your like top guys kind of lead some of the drills and stuff. She kind of took over that role, and she just took me under her wing. And so I did a show in Southern California somewhere in some warehouse or something, and. I believe it was my second show, but she told me, she's like, I have a booking in San Francisco if you're interested in it. And jeez. I was like, yeah, that sounds cool to me. And I was my fifth grade at this point, so I was a lot older. And I had asked to miss a day of school. But so my parents drove me up to San Francisco, and it was for Fog City Wrestling. And the story we were doing, I was going to be the younger brother of Dylan Drake. And it was okay. Dylan and I believe Kenny King. And they were wrestling Rick Luxury, who would turn out to be a huge part of my wrestling career later on. And I think probably MPT. And Marcus Mack was the manager, I remember. And my big spot of the night was I got to kick Mack in the nuts and then give him a sliced bread. And yeah, so I'd wrestle here and there. I'd have some bookings every now and again. And then by the time I got into sixth grade, I just got into a phase of being over wrestling. Wasn't as excited. I wasn't as into watching it because now I was doing it. I just kind of got over the whole thing, and I just eventually stopped.
At some point, you know, everyone catches those types of feelings, and at such a young age, man, you know, you kind of want to do other things. You know, like, you know, be a actual kid, you know, I mean, we all know that it's hard to be a worker as it is, and to be that young, you know, it definitely would take its toll on you. And I've always known you to have a short attention span, so you know you so okay, so let's fast forward.
Well,
let's fast forward a little bit. You know, you when I first met you, you know, you were going to college out in Santa Cruz, right? And you started getting the bug again, right?
Yes.
So you wanted to come and train. You ended up at Pro Wrestling Revolution Training Academy. I remember seeing you that first day. You came in some ripped up jeans.
Oh,
no
my
shirt.
God.
Yes.
He came in. He comes into the backside of the academy, right?
He did.
And
he's like, I remember.
Hey, man, you know, it's
I thought
wrestling.
That's how you'd get
I was like, well, did the ring not give it away? I was like, who is this kid, right? And then Thunder Rosa, who was training with us for a while, says, hey, what's up, Jack? And I was like, okay, well, you know, Rosa knows him and stuff. And
yeah, she was
so
there.
He came in and he talked to Shannon. And he goes, no, I don't want to get in. I just wanted to, you know, come check out the place. And then he left. He just left.
Yeah, well, dude, okay, let me tell you the real story. By that point, I had picked up wrestling again, and I'd been wrestling for about a year. It was my senior year of high school. I was just wrestling this kind of dingy little warehouse in downtown somewhere. But it came time to move for college, and I was like, man, this is a bummer because now I really am into wrestling. And I wanted to keep it going, but I didn't know anyone up in that area or anything. So I just Googled. I was like, Northern California wrestling schools. And what came up was Gold Rush and Revolution. And just Revolution was more convenient spacing-wise, and it had some good reviews online. So
he was very vague on everything he answered. Like, he didn't want to give away like where he was from, when he'd show up. He just said, "I'll show up one of these days." I was like, "No, you just can't show up one of these days. Like, you got to give me a date." Okay, what dates? I'm like, Tuesday or Thursdays. And he's like, okay, well, I'll see if I can stop by. And I was like, dude, what? Like, okay, you know, like, whatever.
Yeah. Well, so then I had a girlfriend. Who
a cougar
who lived in San Francisco. She was like a year older than me, so she'd been in college, and my whole family was up there.
Shout out to cougars!
Shout out to the cougars of the world.
I mean, I guess you could say that. That's from my cougar. Shout out to the cougars. My whole family was up there though, checking out the college, and I had wanted to go see this girl, but I couldn't really say like, hey, will you guys just stay in Santa Cruz, and I'm gonna go see this girl for the day. So I said, is it cool if I take the car and I go check out the wrestling schools of the area? Because that's a big important part for me. If I'm going to live here, I need to know there's somewhere I can go wrestle. And not that I didn't want to check out the schools, but so my plan was I was going to come into the school and then go and see her. So that's why I didn't get in that day, because Shannon was like, are you sure you don't want to get in? I was like, yeah, I'm okay, because I'd already told her I'd be there a couple hours later. But yeah, as soon as I saw it, I felt the vibes. I knew that
that's awesome.
It was all going to be good. That actually made me feel a lot better about moving up there, and I knew that I was going to be in a good place. Yeah, and that I've told you this before. I really hated going to school that year. It wasn't what I had wanted it to be. And coming every week and being with you guys was really what got me through that. And it was the best time of being up there. And really, I feel like it ended up changing my life in the long term.
Well, I mean, I don't know if you remember, but like,
I'm very grateful for that.
Thunder Rosa, you know, knew who he was, and she like, oh my God, I can't believe he was gonna come here. And I was like, just another student, you know what I mean? Like, and she's like, yeah, but you know who he is. And I was like, yeah, Jack. And that's all I knew. I didn't remember his last name. I didn't know nothing. He was Jack. And she kept telling me, yeah, and so cool. And she just assumed that I knew, you know, there was more, you know, to Jack. And I was like, I don't know what the fucking big deal is, man. That's Jack. Yeah. And he hasn't even come to one class yet. You're already making him out to be the next star. I was like, have him come to class. The guy showed up in jeans, no shirt. You know what I mean? And I'm supposed to let the guy come in and like, sweep me off the, you know, off the canvas. Like, get out of here. And then he finally showed up.
Yep.
And the funniest thing, Papa, you guys don't know this stuff, but when Shannon was having him fill out, the paperwork, and because we have insurance and so on, but he didn't want to give up his address. He didn't want to put his full name. I was like, dude, you got to put your name down. You can't train here. What are you so afraid of? So he put stuff down, and it still didn't click with me at all. Not until about 2 weeks later, someone goes, hey, you got so-and-so there. And I was like, who's that? And he goes, well, that guy you have. And I was like, Jack? Yeah, what about him? And the day I found out, you know, what his other, you know, side of his life was besides wrestling, I walked up and I said, hey, bro, is this true? And he goes, yeah. I go, I just want you to know, I don't give a rat's ass who your dad is, what, because he don't wrestle, you do. So I hope to God you want to bust your ass in here, because I don't care what your dad does. It has nothing to do with you in the ring. And I almost felt like that took like a weight off your shoulders. If I'm wrong, correct me, but I felt like you actually felt, oh God, finally someone doesn't give a rat's ass, you know?
Yeah, that was cool. That was, you know, in the very beginning when I'd moved I was driving back down to SoCal all the time to wrestle. And then I ended up I stopped going down there because that was this like article had come up, right, kind of exposing that, and it had been something that I had tried to keep secret for a long time. And just the way it came out and everything, I wasn't happy with it, and I felt like I couldn't go down there anymore. So then, you know, when that happened, to come up here, and it felt cool
just to be your own person,
to know that,
right,
you guys were genuine.
Just to be your own person, your own entity.
Yeah.
You don't have to worry about anyone thinking you're riding off of anybody's coattails, or at least a ding.
Well, the thing is, though, that's what I was told.
That is awesome
that
you took
that
stance.
People would think that, but I told them, what coattails are you going to ride? Your dad's not a wrestler. Your dad can do shit, you know, for you in the ring. I go, brother, you got to put the work in, man.
Yeah.
You know, and but then I saw him work, and I was like, how long have you been doing this for? And he goes, since I was 6, 7, whatever. And I was like, oh, my God. I go, how young were you? I've been training with here and here and here. And I knew the moment I actually had him for that time period when we're training with him, I knew he was an absolute freaking natural. And it's very rare because, for the most part, naturals always quit the business. In my 20 years, the people who are always the most talented, who get it the quickest, are the ones who quit first. And I was like, well, let's see if this kid hangs out, man, because in my experience, you know, they end up quitting. And it was just like, boom, boom, he's getting in. He was quick, you know, and he was so open learning. You know how you said with Rick Drayson, he wanted to just do his own bump? He was the furthest thing from that, you know. Such a level-headed kid, so open to learning, never really were out of line, and you're always willing to help. To this day, you're still the same person. And that's why I always tell you, it's like, man, I miss you, because, you know, you're saying that we were genuine. Wow. It's so hard to even talk to people nowadays that you knew from yesteryear, let alone the ones who actually have some television time, you know, that actually want to talk to you anymore. So, I think, you know, you say we changed, you know, your lives wrestling-wise. Well, you at least made us believe that the dream still can come true because, you know, look where you're at. You know what I mean? And that's the goals we all want.
Oh,
yeah, man, absolutely.
Oh. Yeah, well, dude, I was I would just, as you know,
yes,
I was planning. Yeah. We had a show booked, and I was going to come down and train with you guys because before all this went down. But every time I come down,
I love the fact when he puts
I learned new
clips of his moves that he does. And then my students go, oh, we did that with him, huh? I'm like, yeah. They're like, oh, he did it on I tell him he did it on TV, so he owns it now. You can't do it no
more. Yeah, dude, a lot of the stuff. Dude, a ton of the stuff I bust out on TV. It's all from you guys. And everyone's like, whoa, I've never seen that.
So, Jack, before we go any further, I want you to talk to us about your experience in Northern California, from the training to the promotions that you worked for. Just getting started, just cutting your teeth, you know, trying to figure yourself out in the Jungle Boy, you know, persona. Why don't you talk to us about those times?
Yeah. Well, that's a bunch. Let's see. I guess starting with the Jungle Boy persona, that was something that I had attached myself to, really, to get away from I guess who I really am, kind of the other side. There were a lot of people coming up who pushed me kind of in a direction. People would say, like, you know, your character should be your real self. And I knew what they meant by that. And that was, it wasn't something I was trying to do. Because as I said, I wanted to be my own guy. And I wanted to fail or succeed on my own. And so Jungle Boy, in my mind, was like the furthest thing from like a Hollywood kid that you could get. And so that was cool for me, but
were they Nikki's trunks, or where'd you get those trunks from?
Had given me for free. you know, I someone just threw them at me like 10 minutes before my first show. They're like, "Put these on." And I was like, "All right." But so being up there with you guys and all that really helped me kind of like evolve into the character. I remember Gabe telling me all the time, like, it's not enough to just say jungle. Like, you have to be jungle. It has to be more than. And so, it, you know, in a lot of ways, character-wise, wrestling-wise, I feel like I would never be where I am today without what I learned up there. And I got a lot of different things from a lot of different people. You know, I always say Gabe taught me as a wrestler to respect myself,
yes,
to know what I'm worth. Because at that time, I would drive all the way down to L.A., do a show. I'd work like 3 matches in a night and get paid nothing and drive back. And I was like, oh, okay, this is cool. And Gabe was like, dude, what the hell are you doing? And I was like, what do you mean? And he's like, well, you don't get paid? And I was like, no. And he's like, well, you should ask for money. And I was like, oh, man, I didn't know you could do that. And then, obviously, in the ring, Rick helped me tremendously. He gave me this confidence in the ring that I'd never had before. And then, obviously, training with Sky Day.
I remember you going, what the hell is that?
The time I did, literally, it blew my mind.
Yeah.
And I stole pretty much everything I learned in that class, and I still busted out. So just all around, the training took me levels above where I was. The shows up there really kind of changed my perspective on a lot of things too. And this is, you know, I find people have different kind of opinions on this, but I can only kind of tell my story of it. But being up there, the first show I ever worked for you was the biggest crowd I'd ever
me
wrestled
too.
In front of.
Me too. Yep.
Agreed. And then doing the APW shows, those were also like because I was wrestling in a warehouse for like 20 people, and 15 of them were related to me.
Oh my god!
So being up there with you guys, I realized, at least for me, I would see a lot of these guys wrestling like 3 times every weekend in front of like 60 people each night. And I just thought, do I want to wrestle 12 times in a month in front of like maybe 1,000 people total in that whole month? Or do I want to just wrestle twice?
Yeah.
2 shows in front of 1,000 people and then just train a bunch. And for me, I just thought, I don't want to put all these miles in my body and take all these bumps.
Absolutely.
I don't want to work much as possible. I want to work at good, reputable places where people are paying attention to what's going on. That doesn't mean, you know, you got to practice it and do all that, but I'll practice my stuff in training and I'll work on my repetitions there, but I don't want to burn out and just, you know, overuse my body and everything. So that really, and then really it was, because I think it was like right at the beginning of my 5th year, I guess, when I got signed here with AEW. At that point, I was wrestling for 4, really 3 promotions regularly.
What were
like
those?
5. I really only still, from once I moved up there, for 2 whole years, the only shows I did were APW and Pro Wrestling Revolution. That was it. And I do like, I guess, an odd one here in some other state because I wanted to go somewhere else, but those were my only 2 shows. And that is what, you know, that's where I started kind of, I guess, building a name for myself. And people would see, you know, I remember when I off the top rope
of
your show.
Your dad was freaking out.
Was the first time I
the
had
funny it. Thing about that, his dad was wearing a lucha mask the entire show, so no one could recognize him. And so this guy with a mask, I had no idea he had a mask on. He walks up and goes, hey, so what do you think? I was like, think about what? He goes, about Jack. I go, who the fuck is this guy? I was like, who is this guy asking me about Jack? Like, what? And then Robert Thompson goes, bro, that's Jack's dad. And I was like, oh, why does he have the hood on? And they go, oh, never mind. And the moment, because he asked me, when is it coming? And the moment I told him, he wanted to look, didn't want to look, and he kept talking to himself. And he goes, all right, son. And then you hit it. Man, I remember telling Rob, man, I wish my dad, you know, would act like that about what I do. You know what I mean? Your dad was just like on cloud 9, brother. He was just like, that's my son. That's my son. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I was just like, wow. Wow, wow, wow.
Yeah, that was a good day for me, man. And I felt like that day honestly changed a lot. That that clip, as I was saying, was like, that was the first time I ever started getting like attention from the wrestling world, kind of like that clip just started circulating. People were like, oh shit, who is this guy doing these flips and all that? But so I felt like I really started to kind of build a name for myself there.
You expanded.
Really?
So what? One of the things I want to talk about real quick, and I hate to cut you off, that we were talking about your dad. And, you know, I do want to say that your father is, you know, TV star Luke Perry. And I remember that certain time when, you know, we saw him in the Lucha mask. But I also remember other shows that he was coming to, specifically like the Cow Palace shows that we did. where he was backstage, so excited, so involved, you know, just talking with everyone.
Yeah.
And a lot of stuff that he would talk about was always surrounded around you and how proud of you he was. What I want to ask is, you know, how during that time when we were working Pro Wrestling Revolution, we were working APW, you were going down south and working, you know, other promotions, you know, that were of value. He was following you that whole time and he was involved, you know, and I want to know how that, you know, how involved was he and how supportive was he in your rise?
Yeah. Well, he, you know, I feel like I'll focus on it. I feel like I talk about that a lot, but my entire family has always been like extremely supportive. I've never not been supported. And they would just drive up.
Didn't he fly in one time just for that, just like last minute from Canada? And
drive back. Yeah, he flew in for that one. He was going to fly in for another one that got canceled because of the rain. But my family, they're just like that.
That's so awesome.
And they're like that. We all just support each other. And I've just always had a really cool, like, nurturing environment in terms of that stuff. With my dad specifically, he was always very nervous. like that shooting star, for example. I know before that he was hating it. But he'd make me laugh. He thought a Canadian destroyer was called an Australian destroyer, and he'd always call it that, and I'd always correct him, and he'd still do it. He'd be telling me, he's like, you know, I don't think you should be taking these fucking Australian destroyers and shit. Like, it's just going to hurt you. And I'd try to explain him. I was like, it's okay, Dad. Like, I know how to. And he's like, yeah, but I don't know. I don't think you need this shit. He'd always tell me, too, about doing dives. He'd be like, stay in the ring. Nobody can see you if you jump out to one side. So he'd make me laugh with that stuff. He was very protective and stuff. But he just, you know, it. After he died, the first show that I wrestled again was it was for Game Changer Wrestling. It was the spring break show or whatever. And I hadn't wrestled in like a month. And it was weird for me because every match that I had, right before I went out, I'd get a text from my dad. And as soon as it was done, I'd get a text from him.
Oh, man.
And that was the first time that, you know, I ever went out and there wasn't a text on my phone. And it was just stuff like that that he was always just checking in, wanting to know how it went, wanting to see clips of it. So he was very supportive. And it was really cool, and it helped me a lot. And, you know, I had a couple times where I got fed up with it, kind of, just because, you know, I was being impatient, obviously, but I kind of felt certain times I'd see people, and I guess this sounds shitty, but I'd see people that I knew I felt like I was better than them. I knew I was working harder, and I'd see people get things, and I'm like, this shit is pissing me off. I feel like I'm not going to get anywhere. And a big thing for me was also being small. And I remember a lot of people telling me, like, we know you can be a star, but you're probably going to have to take steroids or something like that, because it's just not going to work out if you're this size. And that was actually one of the things. Before he took me to my very first class, when I was 10 years old, he said, I'll support you completely in this. I'll take you. I'll pay. Well, whatever it is, I'll do anything you need. But you have to promise me you're never going to take steroids. Because that was it was kind of shortly after the whole Chris Benoit thing had happened. And, you know, all the details weren't out and everything. But people thought steroids had played a big part in that. And he made me look him in the face and promise him that I wouldn't do it. And I did. And so it would just piss me off because people would tell me, if you would take steroids, guarantee you'd be a huge star. And I would just be so annoyed because, for me, that's not an option. I'll never do that now. And it would just piss me off, like, no matter how much work I do or how good I am, whatever, if that's the one thing that it gets hung up on, that's just, it's going to bum me out. And so at certain times, I'm like, what's the point? Because I don't want to, I'd imagine myself getting right there, almost there, to being signed or whatever it was, and then being like, all right, we want to sign you, but you're going to have to put on weight, however that is. And I was just like, do I want to spend all this time and effort getting there just to, you know, not have it at the end of the day? And I talked to my dad about stuff like that. And he, that was an area where he was really helpful because he'd, you know, he'd obviously in a different career and all that, but he'd been through the whole thing. Wanting to be successful and coming up and all that. So it was cool to be able to hear from someone who'd been there and done it. And had like firsthand experience.
Yeah, because he was in, I mean, I don't want to say he was in a similar business, but I mean, it was an entertainment business. So he was an entertainer just like you. So I'm sure a lot of the advice he gave translated in
well,
some
I mean,
form or
but,
another.
You know, touching on how his dad supported him and his family supported him. I remember, Jack, when we did Dragomania in Mexico. And Jack's dad called me from a blocked number.
Yeah. Oh, they came to
and
that one,
I was like,
yeah.
Blocked number, not going to answer. And I was like, no. I was I'm not going to answer.
He so called me up. From a blocked number.
Calls it again. I hang up.
It was permanently blocked.
Text, but it's like a weird, like, Martian, you know, numbers pop up. I'm like, what is this? And he says, hey, this is Jungle Boy's dad. And it's funny because, you know, you'd always hear, you know, that's Luke Perry's kid. He said, this is Jungle Boy's dad. And I was like, what? And I was like, man. So he wasn't like, hey, this is Luke. No, he was like, wow, this is Jungle Boy's dad. And I was like, oh, dude. And, you know, for me, I had met him, you know, for the first time in like in person at that San Francisco show. And I remember I sat down with him and I got to hear something funny. I don't know if it's just, if everyone knows, but they will now, is I was talking to his dad and I said, hey, you know, I just want to let you know that some of your episodes on that in Beverly Hills, like, were huge for me and impacted my life and this and that. And then Jack walks by and he goes, oh, those shows fucking suck, right? And then Jack goes, yes. You like that stuff? And I was like, dude, that's like, hey, your dad's a freaking, he's like, I don't know, man. I tried to watch it. That shit's no good. And then his dad says, you believe that? He's like, I gave him a set of, like, the pilot, and they're somewhere in his closet. And Jack goes, yeah, I don't even think I ever opened it. And it was the funniest thing because his dad, here's his dad, is, you know, is to all of us, you know growing up in that era. Well, I want it, you know what I mean? Because, like, if you don't want it, dude, I'll take it off your hands. Because ever, Jack goes, yeah, I think I threw that shit away. And his dad was like, see, look, I'm here watching him. He doesn't even watch my show. And it was so funny because, like, he was there as Jungle Boy's dad. He wasn't there asking for a free ticket. When we were in Mexico and he arrived at Reno, Mexico, he wanted it to be a surprise because he was telling me, hey, please don't tell Jack that we're coming. We're going to surprise him. And so now we're in Mexico, and I'm like, and I was telling Royce, I'm like, dude, I can't find Jack's dad. And he's like, what are you going to do? I said, I got to run the locker room, but I can't go looking for his dad, but I can't not have Jack help. Like, what do we do? So then he goes, you got to tell him. I said, hey, bro, he said, what, am I off the show? I said, no. I said, your dad's coming to surprise you, but he's not here, and I can't get him his tickets because I have to run the locker room. And he's like, well, fuck him. Finally, his dad, we connected, gave his dad the tickets. And, you know, and it was crazy because I think, Jack, if I'm correct, didn't they just come for that only and left, the whole family?
Yeah, my mom and my sister, too. They came and they watched the show.
Insane.
And then I remember, because we went out with all the guys after, and I told them, I was like, if you guys are still up, I'll see you after. But they said, they're like, it's okay, we'll see, because I was going to be home 2 days later. But yeah, they just came to watch it, and then they took off. And dude, thank God that he left before the next day, because when we were having that match, I remember thinking my dad would be losing his fucking mind if he was here. Yes, dude. That was, I never told
he
him about
jumped,
that.
He would have jumped the guardrail.
He would have been. He would have gone ballistic. Dude, that was nuts.
Yeah, because if he would have been in Nocalpa IWRG the next day, I honestly, I have no doubt that he would have jumped in, bro. Because the liberties that locker room took, the liberties that those wrestlers took, And they know who they are, and I hope they're listening because I've told it to them in the locker room when I was there. Yeah. I told them upstairs in the office, and I told them in their face when the match was over. They took liberties with you guys that they crossed the line on many levels, and I believe they took it. I have my reasons why, and you guys know what my reasons are, and I don't want to involve those people. But I went to bat, and I'm sure when that VCR came out and it was coming towards you, I'm pretty sure, you know, if not your sister, because your sister sounds like she got enough training to go along with you to at least be able to jump in. But you're right. It's a good thing they did go home, because if they would have went the next day in Nocalpan, it would have been a whole different story, yeah. You know, going on the news boards.
Well, dude, fuck. I wished I had gone home.
Wow.
Yeah,
I remember the journalist comes up to me and he says, "Man, last night you guys were at Arena Mexico, the Cathedral of Wrestling,
we made
and the next day
alive.
You're in this dump."
I'm glad that we had that. Yeah, dude, it was cool for me. We got to see the top and the bottom of Mexico in 2 days. A lot of good memories.
No, definitely, for sure. And it was cool going into it. I remember you guys sending me texts
about
all the posters you guys were on leading up to it. It was so classic, you know? Yeah.
Dude, we showed up and we were like rock stars, dude. Like, our posters were like put all over all the telephone poles everywhere.
Yeah.
And I was like, and like people in the street.
Yep.
Like we had to, like, it was hard for our Uber to get in.
Well, they were there to take pictures of Panda. Let's just be real.
And stuff. And I was like,
you know,
dude,
they were there to take the picture of Panda.
Know who we are.
The real star of the whole group, you know?
The real star. Fair enough. yes. Yeah,
for sure. So, Jack, I want to keep the ball rolling here, because after Dragomania, I feel like your career started picking up tremendously. I mean, you were going down to SoCal for some of the I don't want to say, you know, big promotions down there, but I mean through like bar wrestling and things like that, you were able to meet like the Luchasaurus and start your team with him.
Well, that actually this is how it happened. It went I started building a name for myself in Northern California. And I remember I was determined not to go back to Southern California until I was going to be on PWG. Because in my mind, that was the biggest thing down there. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to go back there when I'm on top. I'm not going to go work all these little whatever. And I remember it was at an APW show. Brody King told me. He's like, I was with Joey Janela this weekend on some indie whatever. And he was talking about you. And I knew a little bit about Joey Janela. Mainly the thing I'd seen was him getting thrown off this roof into a truck with all the glass and all this shit. And I was like, oh man, all right, like that's crazy. But he was like kind of an indie superstar at that point, and that was kind of wild for me. I was like, damn, he knows who I am and all that. And actually the first show that I worked back in Southern California was for Game Changer Wrestling, which I thought was kind of cool, because they're actually from New Jersey. And so I got in contact, Joey Janela got in contact with me, and I got in contact with those guys, and we worked it all out. And that was my return to Southern California. And for me, it wasn't PWG, but it ended up being even better, kind of, because that was my return. And I was returning with something big the way I wanted to. Because when I had left, I felt like I'd kind of been betrayed in a way, and I felt like I'd been pushed out, and I trusted a bunch of people, and it just didn't work out. And so to come back with that, with kind of like the world watching, I was like, all right, man, this is my time.
Oh.
And my dad was there at that one too. That's the one where David Arquette almost got killed. And yeah, that match, I knew that changed my life right when it was happening. It was funny because, and I was thinking about you guys then too, I was wrestling this guy, Tony Deppen, and we were putting together my shine, and I was like, okay, well, I want to hit like four arm drags, like just all these different cool arm drags, which are sky down, all this stuff you guys showed me. And so it was like arm drag, something, spinning arm drag, another cool arm drag, and then a crazy one. And he said, he's like, just hit a drop kick at the end of it, because it just needs an exclamation point. Like, the arm drags are sick, but just finish it with something. And so I was like, all right, I didn't really think about it. I was like, whatever, drop kick, whatever. So I hit the drags, and I hit the last one, and everyone was like, oh, shit. And I hit the drop kick, and when I stood up, the entire place got on its feet and started screaming. And I knew right there with the drop kick, I was like, it's going to be different from here on out. And the next day, the next morning, I got booked for PWG. And then everyone was trying to book me. I'd been doing bar wrestling a little bit, but at that point I was like, you know, and then before I even did the first actual PWG show, I was already signed with AEW. But at that point I figured I was like, you know, I could go all around and wrestle everywhere, but I just got signed. I'm going to stick with the guys who got me here. I don't want to hurt myself before we get going. So I'll just stick with my.
Well, we're here, man. Let's talk about that. What were the events leading up to actually Cody hitting you up and you getting through with the negotiations and everything?
Yeah. So it was. Well, it was cool because. So I told you the first time Brody told me, he's like, Joey Janela has been talking about you. And I was like, all right, that's cool. That's kind of crazy. But I didn't really think anything would happen. So I was like, I'm sure Joey Janela sees a bunch of stuff. So then I get in with the Game Changer guys and I'm doing a couple shows for them. And I was at this show in Chicago. And then Joey Janela told me, he was like, you know, I've heard people at AEW talking about you. And again, I was like, wow, that's awesome. But I kind of was like, I mean, they could kind of have anyone they want. Like, why would they pick me? And the next morning, I got a text from Cody. I was at breakfast with my whole family. And I got a text
from Cody. Oh, yeah.
And it was snowing. And I remember I had to leave the restaurant because I was freaking out. And I went to stand out in the snow. And
yes.
Well, this I was going to say this earlier. This was actually funny because Cody did one of those Cow Palace shows. And that was the one, dude, that show a little bit, it kind of broke my heart because I told my whole family, I was like, I'm wrestling in the Cow Palace, come up here, like come watch me. And like a bunch of people came and it was this battle royal. And I was like, I'm going to do all this crazy stuff. I was thinking for months about like what cool shit I could do. And I go and I see the card and it says I'm getting eliminated in like 60 seconds. And I was like, are you fucking kidding me, dude? Like, so many people just came to this. You know what it was, too? Most people, I'm looking at the card, most people come in and they have 90 seconds and the next guy who comes in eliminates them. On mine.
Oh, so you were doing the bushwhacker.
I'm supposed to come in and get eliminated by the guy who came out before me. And I was like, are you kidding me? Dude, so I had to go around and beg people. And Papa, I actually did my spot with you, and I was so thankful for it because I was begging people, like, "Can I please just have literally 90 seconds?
Get rid of me. You jumped high for you jumped high. We did our spot. I almost dropped you. I think if you watch the footage, it actually got a pop because when you jumped so high, and when you came down, I almost like I bent my knees, and if I hadn't have bent my knees, I wouldn't have been able to just chuck you back up.
Well, because for me, I was like, I only have like literally a minute. So everything I do has to be like the best I can do. So I was like, fuck it. I'm going to jump as high as I can. But right after that, I remember my dad just came backstage. And I was like, you motherfucker, what are you doing back here? You can't be just coming back here. Like, no one else's dad is coming here. But all the boys are a bunch of marks. So they're like, oh my God, Luke, how are you? And I was like, you guys, now you're making him think he can fucking be in here and all this shit. But it was cool. And we had a good time and everything. And then he knew Cody was there. And he said, where's Cody?
Wow.
Because my dad and Dusty had kind of ended up being friends a little bit, actually. That was his like childhood hero. And I said, I was like, Cody's in the back, but Cody has like his own locker room. And my dad said, it's okay, and just started walking up the stairs. And I was like, Dad, you can't go in there. Like, please do not. You cannot go in there. And he just walks in the door, and Cody's standing there in his underwear, like his real underwear, not his wrestling shirt, like his boxers. And my dad just walks in and shakes his hand. And I was so embarrassed. I was like, I cannot believe this, dude. He's barged in. You hear this guy's in his underwear and his socks, and my dad's talking to him. And Cody said to me, Cody was always really cool with me at those shows too. And he said, I look forward to when you and I have our match one day. And I was still, I still had those stupid red.
Is that why you wore the red trunks?
I was like, oh my God, that's crazy. And it's funny because we just actually had it. And I thought about that moment. I had some different trunks this time. There's some like green. I busted out my special ones. I was gonna have a bunch of right. made, but then all this.
Well, just so you know, I should have dug out the old. Beg me for 90 seconds.
Funny red
I
ones.
I always gave Jack plenty of time. I still remember. You know, one of the coolest moments Jack,
yep.
I remember.
Dude, you gave me Wrestling Revolution tag team title.
You sent me tag with footage because it was an iPay-per-view on Fight.tv. Or I don't remember what it was, but I think it was there. And the footage of your tag partner's family watching you guys win the belts and how those kids just lost it. The crowd popped. I mean, it was such a great moment, you know. And I just want to put out there that it wasn't 90 seconds. It was more 9 to 10 minutes. But you know what? You were doing a lot of stuff. You went from fourth grade, 11 years old, to taking a huge break to senior in high school to graduating. So you had those pockets, you know, where you dropped out, you know, you took to life and then you came back. But from the moment you started again, it's been 100 miles, you know, and running, you know what I mean? NWA.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You're going fast. Like, you know, you came to us, you trained, you started to do some shows with us. And then once Marcus Mack at APW saw that you were doing shows again, he started booking you. And then you flash forward, and like a couple years later, you're in AEW. It's funny you say that you were out in the snow because you called me right after that. Yeah, right after. And I was putting in gas in the car, and he says, "Hey, can you talk?" And I was like, "Oh, man, you can't do the show."
Yeah, I called you. I knew it. I was still out there.
He goes, No. I have news. And I was like, "What?" And he tells me, and I was like, "Sign, go." He goes, "No, I am. And I knew from that moment, I go, "Yeah, man, if he signed, I go, that's it. You know, the kid's gonna take off. People are gonna love him because you're a very lovable person. Not because the ring. It's and I tell people this all the time. It's not always about the ring. Yes, the ring plays a big portion, but your who you are, your attitude, your who you are as a human being is what's gonna keep you there much longer than your in-ring ability. And I knew it. I mean, everyone who's been with you and Ashley is like a true friend or what have you, they knew, you know. So after you did a couple of bookings, like at King of Indies, you know, we told you, "All right, bro, we're not going to see you again." "Yeah, you are." And I'm like, "Well, I'll see you on TV, but you won't be back," you know. And so the last show you did for me, you already signed, and we were like, "Hey, you know, AEW's, you know, Jungle Boy." But we all knew, you know, And it's just the beginning. You know, this pandemic has obviously slowed some stuff down for everyone in the wrestling business. But that match you had with Cody was, you know, I could tell at the end of the match, you know, I could tell that, you know, you could tell in Cody's face that, you know, man, you know, I just had a really cool match with this kid. And I'm sure some of those things that you're sharing with us now is something that obviously might have played in his head, is thinking about your dad, the relationship that he had with his father. And that definitely gave a bond to you guys. So, you know, I couldn't be happier, you know, watching that match. And, you know, I still think you should have whooped his ass, and, you know, and, you know.
I want to touch on that match. But before we do, I don't want to sidestep the your early days in AEW. I mean, I want you to talk about, you know, what it felt like to actually come to an agreement to get signed. And honestly, I mean, let's be real here. You came from, you know, shows that were mainly, you know, house show environments, and now you have to dive right in head first, feet first, or whatever you want to call it, into TV. Talk to me about some of the challenges that you were faced with doing that, and how, you know, some of the pros and cons and stuff.
All right. Well, the thing about getting signed that's kind of crazy is, you know, it has been pretty quick. I think I'm going into like my sixth year wrestling now or something, but there were times where for me it felt like it was a long time, even though it's been pretty really quick in the scheme of things. It felt to me sometimes on those drives by myself, I was like, man, this is taking a long time. And you spend so much time thinking about like, one day when I'm signed, and one day when I make it, whatever. And then all of a sudden it just happens. And then it's kind of just like, oh shit, like this is it. Like, I'm literally here right now. Like, this is it happening. I've been waiting all this time, and, like, it's time to go. And, dude, it just, it starts moving quick. It, you know, I'd never done any TV wrestling or anything like that before. And then I'm getting, you know, it is intimidating, but it's also helpful. But I'm on the right. same TV show as Chris Jericho.
Right.
And I'm like, oh, shit, dude, I gotta pick this up quick. I gotta be able to kind of hang with these guys. And, you know, being here and all, my match with Chris specifically has changed my kind of perspective on wrestling a lot. You know, I do think there are different strategies for different places. And I think the indies, in a lot of ways, I think you do have to do a lot sometimes, depending who you are. The indies is, in a lot of ways, like about like just generating clips or whatever, or like whatever it is to get some buzz. People just need to see you.
Yeah.
And so that, but a lot of people take it too far, and that's why everyone's trying to cram as much as they can into, as you know. But then when you get to TV, it's not like that. But at first I thought it was, and I was like, all right, I'm on TV. I got to do everything I know how to do. I got to show everyone that I – but then, you know, wrestling with Chris, I remember thinking like, fuck, I'm not doing that much. Like, I've had matches where I've done way, way more, and I was worried. I was like, people are not going to – but then I realized, it was like, when I do less, each thing becomes its own kind of moment, and it is more meaningful and impactful. Yeah. And that felt weird to me, because you and people have been telling me that the whole time. And I was always like, all right, whatever, fuck these guys. What do they know? But then when I got there, then I felt like an old man. I was like, wow, I cannot believe I'm saying this, but it's not about doing as many moves as you can do. But it, you know, it's been really cool for me, and I feel like it's cool for me to be coming in, you know, because the company is new. So I feel like it's cool to be new with the company, because I'm learning how to be a TV wrestler, and you know, there have been a lot of good,
and you were, in my opinion, one of the focal points. I mean, I remember when AEW first started up. I mean, even before you actually started. You know, doing TV and such, you were in a lot of the pictures and a lot of the video footage of the preliminary, yeah. you know, marketing and stuff for AEW alongside Cody and Brandy and a lot of the Young Bucks.
Yeah, that was very cool. It was great. How did that make you feel? Times, you know, it was because I lived in LA, but I guess it was like the TV upfronts when we're right. all the new shows are like pitching their stuff and getting ready. And they asked me to go to it, and I went, and it was like, I'd wear kind of a suit, but I'm sitting in a room, and it's like me, Cody, the Bucks, Kenny, and Tony, and Brandt. Like, yeah. I was like, damn, they have me in here with them. That's crazy. Like, I'm a nobody in the scheme of things, and they brought me in. And so it's very humbling, but it's very exciting at the same time. Like, damn, these guys are investing in me, and they obviously believe in me, and it feels nice. It's crazy to me when people now, like, in public, people will come up to me now and ask for a picture, and I'm like, damn, that's crazy. I say, get out of here.
You shine them off?
No, I, dude, it's awesome. I know, yeah. It's exciting.
Yeah, I remember in Dragon Mania, people kept asking for pictures. Jungle boy. He's like, what do they want? I go, they want your picture. Why? I was like, dude, just go take a picture with them. Jeez. He's like, all right.
Yeah.
So as far as the TV aspect of it, I mean, I got to say, you know, working for companies like Pro Wrestling Revolution, who, you know, I mean, we've done, you know, global, yeah. you know, internet pay-per-view where yeah. there's several cameras everywhere. And I know Gabe is real big on the production aspect of it, you know, knowing where the hard cam is, you know, knowing when to and when yeah. not to circle towards the ring area cameras and such. Did a lot of the stuff that Gabe taught us in Pro Wrestling Revolution, as far as that production, help you at all in understanding how, on a grander scale, AEW was doing with all that, you know, I mean, God, there must have been 1,000 cameras around you at once. You know, camera one.
The cameras turn to camera two. So much. I mean, I'm sure I'd fuck it up still, but the cameras weren't so much. What was kind of for me now, it's like the time and stuff. Like, that's complete. Because, like, on the Indies, you have your time and you're supposed to stick to
it. No big deal.
But if you go over...
Except in my locker room.
Whatever, kind of. Yeah. This shit... Yeah, well, that's true. That's true. But the time is the crazy part to me. And, like, now trying to figure out when I'm calling something, like, how long is this realistically? Not, like, can I do it in this amount of time, but, like, how long is this going to be if I do it properly? And it's just learning stuff like that. But then again, that's where it helps to have people like Chris, like Cody, like who have been doing this shit for a while.
Do you go to Chris and a lot? No, have they made themselves available? Well,
they're super available. We were actually just talking. Me and Marco were talking to Chris the other day. He's very helpful with his input. It's such a cool environment. Nobody there is, like, too good for it. Like, I can just go knock on Cody's door at any time and come in and talk to him about whatever it is I need. I need help. The other day, I was like, I need help, like, just coming up with a finish for this thing. Can you help me? And we figured it out. And Chris all the time, like, what do you think about it? And he'll just come to me, and he'll be like, I have some ideas for you to do. And I'm like, wow, you're taking the time out of your day to help me out. That's crazy. So the whole team is there. It really is just like a big team, and everyone's trying to help everybody do the best they can. So I feel very lucky in that, because I don't think it's like that everywhere you go necessarily.
Yeah. So with AEW, I mean, I talked about this in a previous episode where, you know, in order for you to get better as a performer, I feel like you have to be in the ring with people that are better than you. And when you're wrestling guys like Chris Jericho, you know, and you're in there, you know, at what point do you start seeing things differently in terms of how to structure a match, slowing the pace down, speeding the pace up, you know, knowing what's more meaningful than the next, you know, in terms of a move or a punch or whatever. What were some of the matches early on in AEW and even now that would you would say kind of opened your eyes a little bit more and made you a little bit more seasoned as a wrestler?
I'd say the two for me were the ones with Chris and the one I just had with Cody. The first pay-per-views, I was still trying to do everything I could do. And this one I just had with MJF, actually, too. The one with Chris... That was my first singles match, which was kind of freaky because I hadn't had a singles match there ever, and I hadn't really had a singles match in a while, even on the indies. And that I've never trained harder for anything in my life. I was so scared that I was going to get blown up or whatever. I was just going nuts, and I think I was in like the best shape of my life for that. What that taught me kind of it taught me to have my things that were my things. And before on the indies, I used to try and do different stuff every match because I felt I was like, if I just do the same shit over and over and over again, it's going to look like I'm lazy and people are going to just be like, oh, well, we saw this last time. You know, it is what it is. But that is another thing where TV is different, where you're trying to familiarize an audience with your stuff. And doing it with Chris kind of showed me that. That's the first time I hit those three dives in a row. And I said, I was like, it's like a Lope suicide, a regular suicide, and a flip. And I was like, people do all those other moves. So like, but he told me, he's like, nobody does them all together. And that's going to be your thing, the three of them. And I was like, oh, okay. And so I did it. And then, sure enough, that is my that's my go-to thing now.
Now, do you think Papo can borrow that?
Recognize that. Dude, you can do whatever you want, dude. Hit that shit.
Oh, yeah. I'm stealing everything. No, it's definitely great to see that you're actually starting, you know, your journey. I mean, even now, I mean, you're on AEW television. You're starting to make a name for yourself. You're starting to get known everywhere. What do you feel is next. I mean, you reach certain plateaus all the time, and if you're hungry enough, you're always going to say, "What's next? What is next? What is next for Jungle Boy in terms of the AEW saga, the AEW journey? What are your goals? What are your aspirations? How do you feel you're going to take Jungle Boy to the next level?"
I mean, it's interesting because I'm actually happy with the team that I'm in. It's cool. I've been in a tag team once before, but this one's totally. It's cool because now I feel like I'm starting to get tag wrestling a little bit, and I'm finally, because when you kind of get thrown into a team with someone, it's kind of just like, oh well, what do you do? What do I do? I guess let's just do all our moves back to back, kind of. So now is where we're getting to know each other better. I know what his shit is. I'm like, oh dude, you could do this while I do that. Like, it just, we're starting to put it together in a way, and that feels cool. At the same time though, I like having these singles matches. I want to work with everybody there because I'd like to learn a little bit from everyone I can. I just had my first singles pay-per-view ever, which was cool for me. So I'd like, I don't know, I feel like I'm on a kind of steady climb up, and I'd like to just keep moving upwards. I just want to have good matches. I'm having a blast, which is not what it's all about, but I think it's probably a lot better if you're having a good time. And I'm having so much fun every week. So I just want to keep moving up, keep getting better, and then sooner or later I'm coming for all these belts.
Coming for all the belts, including those tag belts. Dude, like you mentioned, your tag team, the Jurassic Express.
I've not said this in public, but I'll just say it here for the first time ever. I would like, at some point or another, to have every belt that there is in that company.
Well, how can we get the Luchasaurus and yourself?
That's a goal, man. I mean, I think we have all the tools.
King Fatboy and Rico Dinamita and do the Lucha Horsemen. Versus let's do the Lucha Horsemen.
Rico
versus you know whatever combo you want to do, but I like to see the Luchasaurus come in the Pro Wrestling Revolution. You know, let's bring it back.
Yeah, dude, when everything opens back up, we can see.
Yeah, I'm gonna say for the record, you don't want that smoke. So go ahead and enjoy your time in AEW.
Wow.
You can come back to my house anytime you want. Just wipe your feet.
Oh, man.
Oh, man. That is awesome. So, you know, I mean, this has definitely been a great conversation, man. I like to ask you one question real quick, and this actually pertains to people that are listening. You know, we got a lot of people that listen, from fans to, you know, wrestlers to referees to, you know, whoever. And for the wrestlers, you know, for the young up-and-coming wrestlers who were in your spot, you know, 5-6 years ago and aspire to be where you're at, what type of advice would you give them in order to have a chance to get where you're at or you know, be able to make a name for themselves? I mean, what advice would you give based on your experience alone?
I think honestly, being different is a big part of what helps. And you know, thinking back, I felt like a lot of times that it was, you know, I didn't get put on a lot of shows that I really wanted to be on. Certain promotions, they would tell me like, you can't be on here because your character is too goofy. We can't have that on the show. And there were times, I actually talked to you about this once.
To do a show,
Goofy little.
He told
shows.
Me, "Hey, what do you think about this?" I was like, "Why?" And he's like, "Oh, because that's the only way I can get on the show because of X, Y, and Z, and I have to go do this, and I have to go do that." And I was like, "Dude, who you know?" And I was like, "No, dude, you are who you are, and don't change yourself. You know what I mean? You got to stay true, you know. And that's one thing you've always been, is true to yourself. Yeah. Why change it now for a booking?" It's not like they gave you a contract that you're making a living and they're all right, you know what, Jungle Boy, now you're going to become a rabbit. Okay, you know, you're paying me to do something. That's my job. But it was for one booking and they were treating you like a mark. And I remember me telling you, no, bro, do not let him do that to you.
Yeah. And that was definitely, for me, it was like everything seemed so much bigger. And I was like, I need to get on this one show. And that, you know, I had moments where I was like unsure of myself. And that's where the other thing is, surround yourself with good people. I was very lucky to have you guys, because there are a lot of people who are not great people out there. And, you know, you got to work to find the good people. The being different also just in the ring. You know, there were times I remember there was like there was a phase where I saw so many clips of everybody doing a sling blade. And I was like, you know what?
Good.
I'm just going to say to myself right now, I'm not going to do a sling blade. Because literally everybody's doing it. And so just like wherever you can find a way to be different, you know, with wrestling too, that like this might get kind of insider, but whatever. But people have seen so much wrestling that they kind of know what's going on a lot of the time. Right. Like, for example, I'll do this a lot. Like, when you give someone a shoulder tackle and you hit off the ropes and they go to drop down, everybody knows you're going to run over them and then they're going to leapfrog, whatever. So a lot of times I'll hit the ropes, and when they do a drop down, I'll do a cartwheel over them. And it's literally, it's nothing. But it's not the normal that people are expecting to see. So it kind of just wakes them up, and they're like, oh, wait.
Preach.
That's not the basic thing we're used to. I'm gonna pay a little more attention to this. So whatever it is, if you can just get people to kind of wake up and be like, oh, shit, what is this guy doing? I think that's important.
You're so correct. So correct. Yeah, that's right. I think I've heard that before.
Yeah, it definitely is. Sounds like someone we know, right? We've heard that before somewhere. And, you know, Gabe, I mean, just for the record, you know, I hate to go off topic, but, you know, I mean, Jack is right, man. You definitely helped a lot of people, you know, see things differently and really, you know, think outside the box when it comes to our sport. And, you know, I'm very glad that guys like myself and Jack are humble enough to continue to say that, man.
I think really a perfect example, like, you know,
it's definitely
like I'm a true believer of never dangling a carrot in front of somebody, you know, to promise them that, you know, come train here, because if you come train here, you're going to be, I'm going to take you here, I'm going to take you there. And I've seen that happen too many times in my time in this business. And even with Jack, you know, we talked about it. I told him, you know, it doesn't matter who your dad is. I think it's super cool who your dad is, but it has something to do with wrestling. And the fact that Jack can say, you know, that I've helped him, even a smidget, I don't care if it's 1% to whatever, I was able, well, at least two, right? But I was able to I was able to guide him. And whether it was wrong or right, it was my honest to God best intention, advice, you know, anything I could have given him was for his best interest, not mine. Because the idea is not, you know, I would love to have no one ever leave that's come through my company for the most part. You know, I wish I still had, you know, Jungle Boy. I wish I still had Tom Caster. I wish everyone that's ever come through those doors, whether they're on TV or not, some have moved on to other places, greener pastures, what have you. I would love to still have them because I'm greedy as a friend and greedy seeing good workers and having that. But if Jack comes to me and said, hey, brother, I'm going to go drive to, you know, to buttfuck Egypt for $5, man, what do you think? Do it, man. No, man. I was like, what? No. I always gave him the best advice. And I remember yeah. this. And you know, it is what it is. I remember Jack came into our class and he did something, and I go, hey, who taught you that? And he goes, what do you mean? I say, well, who taught you that move right there? And he goes, oh, well, I was taught this way. And I don't know if Jack remembers or not. And I said, Jack, I want you to do me a favor. When you get home, I want you to text your trainer and tell him he fucking sucks. Right? Because, you know,
yes.
if I was just blowing yes. smoke up his ass, I would say, oh, great, Jack. Great move. No, man. You know, I had nothing. I had more to lose by pissing off, you know, Luke Perry's son, as opposed to teaching Jack.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so if he can say now, oh, man, where'd you learn that? Oh, I learned that at Revolution. Hey, high five to Jack. High five to whoever taught me, you know, and along the lines. Because again, we say it all the time, you guys are extensions of who trained you, good or bad. And if I was able to help you a smidgen or a lot, whatever it is, hey, for me, I'm humbled. I think it's awesome. Facts. And I did my job because in the end, that's what you came to us to do. And I think if I helped you, I did my portion.
Yeah, you did it, man, for sure.
Well, guys, that's awesome, man. That's it. I think we're out of time here. You know, dude, your story is, you know, amazing, man. I mean, that you are on a rise, I think, you know, quicker than most. And, you know, I'm super proud to have known you before. I'm super proud to know you now. And, you know, I'm not going to hold it against you when you forget about me. And, you know, all I got to say, man, is, you know, I know I can speak for Gabe when I say, dude, we love you, man. Papa, we're so proud.
If Jack super has proud, not stopped, you know, talking to us after we did the
tour, you deserve everything that you're getting right now. Yeah.
Yeah, that was some bullshit, dude.
You know,
that was actually,
it's awesome. It's awesome. All the way around. Times, all the way around. I wish we still had footage of Jack consoling Jimmy Twilight in the van. It's telling him how it's going to be.
I'm sure it's
how
somewhere.
It's going to be okay. Then later on, you guys.
Dude, he's a little. Dude, Jimmy you know Twilight what? And Marco okay. Stunt. Dude, that's okay. A good okay.
Do you know what? Now we don't need no combination.
I think so. I think we need to set that up.
All three of you show up. Marco Stunt. And then for one night and one night only, Jimmy Twilight would tag up with the Lucha Horsemen. Six-man tag.
Yes. I like that.
And for those people who don't know, Jimmy Twilight is a phenomenon. The world is not ready
for the man
that is Jimmy Twilight. So that'll definitely be a star-studded event. All right, man. Well, hey, you know, before we go, Gabe knows this. I always like for people to shout out their social medias.
Oh, shit.
Give people a chance to get to know you a little bit more if they don't.
What is my dumbass Instagram?
Go ahead, Instagram, Jack.
And my Twitter.
And I knew this was happening.
Wow. Very ballsy, don't you think?
Dude, I didn't realize it was going to blow up like it did when I picked that name. But whatever.
Man, everything across the board.
Gabriel Ramirez,
PW Revolution.
Jefe,
you guys can
go ahead and shout out your
spread the love
medias,
and
please.
Follow. Also, www.luchamasks with an S luchamasks.com for all your PPP masks, but based off Lucha Libre. And what do you think, Jack? We think we can get a Jungle Boy mask going. You know. Yeah. Let's see what we can do. Maybe we can.
That would be cool.
Put some leaves and some bark. I don't know, but I would love to do something, man. Let's come up. Let's get creative. Let's do something. Let's get some good stuff going.
I'm down, dude.
Maybe we can create some money and donate it to charity or something. So I'd be more than happy to work with you on that. Let's see what we can do.
Hell yeah!
Awesome.
Yeah, let's do it.
Oh, you heard it here first. Lucha-mask.com is gonna. Going to get an exclusive Jungle Boy face cover. I love that. I like that. Well,
of course, my guy,
for coming on the show.
oh, shit.
Let Cody know that his days are numbered, and I'm coming for that. I'm coming for that TNT title. He ain't never faced nobody like me and never will. On behalf of the podcast, you know, I'm your master of ceremonies, the King FatBoy Papo Esco, Gabriel Ramirez, Jack.
All right, brother. Thank
Perry,
you. Be safe.
Jungle
thank
Boy.
Thank you, man. I'll see you guys
we'll
soon.
We'll see you later, brother.
You too.
All right.
And that right there, mi gente, is all she wrote. Huge shout out to Jungle Boy for pulling up to the podcast. Man, so many years ahead of him. So much gas left in his tank. Such a young dude. I can't wait to see what the future holds for him. I'm proud. Hopefully in the next 5 or 6 years, the podcast is still around so we can have him back for another great conversation. But that's another story. That's all the time we got for this week. Join us next week when we sit down with Southern California residents, independent pro wrestling superstars, Lucha Libre superstars, Lucha Underground superstars, Little Cholo and El Mariachi Loco. They're going to pull up. Can't wait for that one. Before we get out of here, check us out on social media. Instagram, Straight Out of the Bodega. Facebook, Straight Out of the Bodega. Twitter, STR8.
LUTDABODEGA. Man, that at gives me goosebumps now. I love that thing. Go check it out. Also, check me out on all forms of social media. That's Instagram, Papo Esco, Facebook, Papo Esco, Snapchat, Papo Esco, Twitter, Papo _ Esco. You know what? I even opened up a TikTok, Papo Esco. I did that because my kids wanted me to, so I got some content up on there. You could check that out. On behalf of the podcast, I am your master of ceremonies, the King FatBoy Papo Esco. Thank you for pulling up to Straight Out of the Bodega. We are out.
Lucha-Masks.com by Pro Wrestling Revolution. Bringing you, in partnership with Mask Republic, the Lucha Brothers, as well as Japanese legend Ultimo Dragon. Go to Lucha-Masks.com and fight Lucha Strong with masks from your favorite Lucha Legends and Pro Wrestling Revolution luchadores. Stay safe in style and represent your favorite luchador. Get yours now at Lucha-Masks.com, powered by Pro Wrestling Revolution.